Philosophy is written in this very great book, which always lies open before our eyes. I mean the universe. But one cannot understand it unless one first learns to understand the language and recognize the character in which it is written. It is written in mathematical language, and the characters are triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures. Without these means, it is humanly impossible to understand a word of it. Without these, there is only clueless scrambling around in a dark labyrinth. Galileo Galilei, the Assayer. With these words, written in 1623, Galileo emerged from a somewhat self-imposed exile to once again join battle with the Aristotelian philosophers who claimed that it was only through the use of reason, reason put forward by some ancient authority, that knowledge of the natural world could be obtained. His declaration of a new method of obtaining knowledge would not only have profound repercussions in Italy, but also across the European continent and in England. The method described in the Assayer would form, in some ways, the foundation for the development of what we now call science. However, in the deep recesses of this publication would be sown the seeds of Galileo's downfall, for in a little red appendix would be statements regarding the existence of atoms moving in a void that would be used as leverage in his trial for heresy. This week, we dig into the events leading up to that trial, that not only imprisoned Galileo, but that branded the work of Nicholas Copernicus as heretical for all of the Catholic world. Hello, and welcome to the Scientific Odyssey. Scientific Odyssey is a mini-part journey into the history and philosophy of science. My name is Chad Davies, and I'm the writer, host, and producer of the podcast, where we consider the ideas, processes, and results of over 2,500 years of scientific inquiry and discovery. Series 3, Finding Our Place. Episode 25, The Heresy of Galileo. When last we left our story, the Congregation of the Inquisition had ruled to censure two ideas, that the earth moves and that the sun does not. In response to this, some action had been taken towards Galileo as a result of his decision to travel to Rome in 1615 to argue that either the Catholic Church shouldn't take a position on a matter that didn't specifically involve issues of salvation or a person's relationship with God, and that the resulting state of their immortal soul, or to argue for Copernicanism and or heliocentrism. The jury's still out on exactly what he was there to do. As we mentioned in our last episode, there's a lot of scholarly debate surrounding the circumstances of just what took place in 1616 when Cardinal Bellarmine warned the Florentine mathematician against holding or defending the ideas of Copernicus. Whatever the specifics were, there are some conclusions we can draw. First, whatever Galileo's goal had been, he had not only failed to achieve it, but had been, in some sense, rebuked in its pursuit. As most historians who cover this event note, had Galileo not traveled to Rome, it's very unlikely that he would have put the Pope, Cardinal Bellarmine, and the Inquisition in the position of having to do or say anything about him specifically. Instead, by making a nuisance of himself and placing himself within reach of the Dominicans in Rome, he had, in large part, precipitated the events that directly involved him. Second, after his defeat, he had to find a way to exit the situation with some grace and dignity. As such, he remained in Rome a good bit longer than he was welcome. This stay, beyond running up enormous expenses and annoying his host, the Florentine ambassador in Rome, convinced Galileo that he no longer wished to participate in the high-stakes game of court intrigue. At the age of 52, he decided that due to the energy required to curry and cultivate networks of contacts, supporters, and followers, that was just more energy than he was willing to expend. In other words, he came to the conclusion that politics at that level was a younger man's game and that he really wanted no part of it. As such, when he left Rome, he retreats to his villa in the countryside outside of Florence and forsakes court life, at least for quite a bit of time. Part of this is likely due to something that will be extremely important down the line. He no longer believes that facts and reason have the power to overcome the entrenched biases of those in positions of authority outside of a few learned circles such as the Lyncean Academy. In this, we see the conflict he finds himself in, as he is well ahead of most of his contemporaries in understanding the emerging epistemological value of observational and empirical evidence over that of authority or deductive reasoning. For us today, at least until very recently, this seems a bit absurd, but we live in a time where such factual authority is well established. In the early part of the 17th century, Galileo's belief that direct observation is superior in establishing the veracity of something is a complete paradigm shift away from most of those around him. While he is careful to limit this assertion to the realm of understanding the natural world, he cannot understand why others would think differently. To illustrate this, it's useful to tell a story. A bit later than this, in the mid-1620s, Galileo is in a boat with a friend of his that is an Aristotelian in terms of his perspective about looking at the natural world and sort of how he explains it. The boat, it's said, is being rowed by six or so really strong men, and so it's traveling through the water at a pretty good clip. Now, I've not been able to find a reason why he would have done this, but the story goes that Galileo asks his friend if he has something fairly heavy on his person that Galileo could borrow. The friend, obliging Galileo's request, hands him the keys to the room at the local lodge the two are staying in. As lock and key technology at this time is somewhat primitive, the keys are fairly massive pieces of iron. Galileo then proceeds to take the keys and throws them fairly vigorously straight up. Now his friend, espousing Aristotle's ideas of motion, thought that the keys, no longer possessing of a force to move them forward since they were no longer in some sense attached to the boat, would fall rapidly behind the moving boat and would end up in the water behind the boat, lost forever. Instead, he was surprised to find that even though the boat covered a distance of some 20 to 30 feet while the keys were in the keys themselves came back down in nearly the same place from which they had been thrown in reference to the boat itself. Galileo knew about the truth that the keys would move with their own inertia from his studies on motion prior to his use of the telescope, something his friend would also have known about and been aware of. This understanding of the motion of objects had been established via numerous experiments and observations, and so Galileo was very comfortable with the new picture he had developed that refuted the ideas of Aristotle. His friend, however, regardless of Galileo's supporting evidence, had continued to treat Aristotle as correct due to the authority granted Aristotle based on the venerable nature of his writing. Thus, this key demonstration, which of course could also be said to be a key demonstration, was something that Galileo's friends should have wholly expected, but it was a tremendous shock as he couldn't reconcile what he saw with his own eyes with what his belief system told him should have been true. That Galileo would have had to encounter this over and over and over again in the years leading up to 1616, and then have it seem to be at the heart of the decision to outlaw the basic tenets of heliocentrism would have galled him to no end. As we understand from our last episode, the issue was a good bit more complex, tied as it was to issues of biblical interpretation and the authority of extra-biblical tradition in the Catholic Church. But I think that for Galileo, it must have seemed like another infuriating example of the intransigence of that community of Aristotelian natural philosophers who clung to their outmoded methods of thinking. Third, when Galileo returned to Tuscany and his villa there, he was in no mood to engage what one might think of as reasonable academic dialogue. Here was a man of great ego and no small vanity who had gambled on just about the biggest stage in Italy and had lost, and he maybe had lost big. He's not going to be one to shake off his defeat and re-enter the scholarly community as if nothing had happened. Rather, he's going to be spitting mad and more than a little inclined to take his ball and go home, if you get my sense here. In other words, he's either going to support heliocentrism, something I think he's pretty darn committed to at this point, or he's going to poke the Aristotelians in the eye at every possible chance he gets, even when it doesn't exactly serve his purpose. And finally, before we get into the next episode of his life, we should spend some time on one more question. Even without Copernicanism, Galileo has at least two areas of work where what he has done is not only breathtakingly original and incisive, but that also refutes the idea of Aristotle, motion and hydrology. Why doesn't he just shift the battle lines to those areas and publish his work there? De motu, his full work on the motion of objects, that includes his law of falling bodies, his understanding of the trajectories of projectiles, and his early formulation of the ideas of inertia, is still unpublished beyond the manuscript form, and there is nothing in the censure of the Inquisition that would impact him putting the finishing touches on that work and getting it into the public sphere. David Wooten, in his biography on Galileo, suggests that while such work would certainly have been interesting to the scientific community, as well as to those working in military engineering, it wasn't something that Galileo saw as truly, you know, shattering. As Wooten puts it, Milton's Adam wouldn't have asked God about how a ball falls from a tower, or how it rolls down an incline, in the way he might inquire about the earth's place in the heavens. Galileo's ego, having tasted the glory of establishing a new order of the cosmos with his telescopic observations, would not be satisfied with something as seemingly mundane as the displacement of water by an ocean-going vessel. Such questions were now of secondary importance to the truly vital matters of celestial dynamics. Galileo was not like Kepler in that he could gladly intermix work on those things more worldly with those efforts devoting to understanding the cosmos or to the heavens. Unlike his German counterpart over the Alps there, he did not see all of his endeavors as understanding the mind of God and thus equally worthy of his intellect. As a result of this, while he did try to spend some time in 1617 working on finishing De Motu, Galileo's main efforts were devoted to attempts to detect stellar parallax as a way of providing Bellarmine's unrefutable demonstration of the Earth's motion. Unfortunately, while his telescopes were the best made in the world at this time, in large part due to the lenses being supplied by his friend and confidant, Giofrancesco Segredo, he lacked all of the necessary tools to make such a precise observation, even though such a measurement might have been within the theoretical reach of his instruments. Thus, when, in the year of 1618, three comets appeared in the heavens, each a marvelous opportunity to make additional observations to investigate their positions and motions, Galileo did not lift either his telescope or pen to contribute to the astronomical conversation about them, at least not at first. Even when sympathetic colleagues offered to arrange publication of his thoughts on comets in France, where there was no Inquisition, he sat out most of the immediate excitement, declining to comment on what the comets might have to say about the organization of the heavens. It is what Galileo did afterwards, though, that is both of interest to us and deeply puzzling when initially considered. In 1619, a Jesuit in Rome, Orazio Grassi, published a small work that placed the observations of the comets squarely in the interpretation of the Tychonic model of the solar system. In doing this, Grassi was conforming to the instruction of the Inquisition not to hold to Copernicanism, but he was very clearly refuting the Aristotelian model of Ptolemy in his analysis. As part of this, he went out of his way to praise Galileo in his telescopic observations of 1611 to 1613, without, of course, specifically referring to him. In response to this, a lecture published under the name of one of Galileo's students attacked Grassi's ideas with particular vehemence. As was suspected then, and then confirmed later, much of the lecture was actually penned by Galileo, and it set off a series of publications wherein the two men sniped back and forth at each other. While the specific details of the debate are beyond the scope of this episode, we can infer a couple of things from it. First, the reason for Galileo's position probably had to do with the rhetorical decision that to embrace Grassi's ideas would be to lend support to the one idea that was still considered a viable alternative to heliocentrism. Secondly, one of the things Galileo seems to do is embrace an Aristotelian idea that comets were sublinear in nature, at least in the work. His arguments, though, for this were obviously incorrect, and as such, there's been a good bit of speculation as to why he adopted them. One idea is that he was trying to show that he wasn't some fire-breathing radical bent on destroying the framework of all natural philosophy. Another is that he takes the positions and represents its arguments as sort of a reductio ad absurdum argument, where his presentation draws out the obvious flaws, thus showing how inadequate Aristotle's ideas on comets really were. If this second interpretation is correct, it's pretty clear that Galileo is doing everything he can to damage the idea that the Tychonic system is any sort of a viable alternative. There's a good deal of evidence that he viewed this geo-heliocentric compromise of the Danish astronomer as a post hoc attempt to save what he saw as the product of a profoundly Aristotelian and thus profoundly flawed worldview. In other words, his disdain for scholasticism's clinging to what he saw as an empirically unsupportable description of the cosmos was transferred over to the model that seemed, at least in his mind, to be bent on saving the incorrect terrestrial-celestial distinction. So there are a couple of results that come from this that are pretty interesting. The first is the publication of a work known as The Assayer in 1623. And it's the last in that series of back-and-forth pieces that Grassi and Galileo, through sort of intermediaries, trade back and forth. As we've mentioned before, it is this work where Galileo puts forth his most coherent statements of how his emerging understanding of how knowledge is to be created and verified are placed. It's really where he sort of puts forth what he thinks of as what we might today call a scientific method. More importantly for our story here is that his continued intransigence on engaging constructively with the Jesuit astronomer leads to a significant deterioration of his relationship with many in that order. What seems to be clear from the exchange is that Galileo is bent on extracting some measure of revenge for the perceived slight of the Jesuits not having stood up for him in 1616 when he could have used their support against the Dominicans at the Inquisition hearings. Therefore, he lashes out at Grassi's work in an attempt to discredit their standing as meaningful participants in the academic discourse. This is really, really unfortunate, because Grassi, who as late as 1624 was willing to meet with Galileo and do so in Rome, was reportedly willing to adopt nearly all of the Tuscan mathematician's views, including Copernicanism. And he seems to have wanted really to mend fences and provide the support that had been lacking 8 years earlier. Galileo, however, has moved on to other things by this point and thus never takes the olive branch. As we have already seen with the case of Scheiner, who will return before this episode is over, by the way, Galileo's unwillingness to play nice with the one group of clerics who don't want to see him strung up for heresy is not the best decision on his part, and in fact, it will cost him rather dearly in 1633. So what can we make of this? What does this tell us about Galileo as a person? The answer to that depends a lot on what you see as his motives in 1615 and 1616, but I think there are a couple of things that we can sort of think about. And in this, I'll be drawing heavily from Wooten's biography of Galileo if you want to check that out. If we take Grassi's attempt to mend fences with Galileo during this dispute as being indicative of a larger movement within the Jesuit order, something I think that's a reasonable assumption, Galileo's being offered here a chance to come in from the cold, as it were. He can join forces with the Jesuits to terminate Ptolemy's model and really call a lot of this Aristotelian thinking into question, possibly leading to its end as well. All he has to do is kind of get on board with the Tychonic model, at least in a hypothetical way, and agree that his observations are consistent with that model. From there, maybe there can be sort of a tacit understanding that, you know, there's something to be said for heliocentrism, and why don't we all just sort of talk about it, and hey, maybe look, maybe we'll move that direction. In other words, what they want him to be in the parlance is a team player, and yet he won't do it. So why doesn't he? Well, if you follow Stillman Drake's ideas, it's because he doesn't think natural philosophy should be decided by theology. For him, it doesn't matter if it's the Aristotelian of the Dominicans or the Tychonic support of the Jesuits, neither should be deciding which descriptions of the natural universe are correct if their criteria involved literalistic readings of scripture and tradition. The whole thing is just a non-starter from the get-go for Galileo. The quote in the introduction from the Asser is a clear refutation of anything apart from this newly emerging methodology he's involved in being a valid way to establish knowledge about the natural world. For Galileo, the facts should speak for themselves, and then the theologians should figure out how to reconcile scripture with them, not the other way around. Now, if you follow Wooten's line of reasoning, it's because Galileo is really just a lone wolf, incapable of allowing himself to be constrained by the program of a larger institution. In the Asser, Galileo refers to himself as an eagle, flying free and high above the flocks of starlings that represent the Aristotelian philosophers that follow each other to and fro, making little or no progress. He was frustrated and angry about the continuous attacks on his work by men less capable and slower thinking than himself. Men mired in the past, unable to break the shackles of things that had been demonstrated, and let me emphasize that, demonstrated to be incorrect. In his mind, he had the evidence needed to arrive at the correct descriptions of the natural world, even a heliocentric model of the solar system. And while he was willing to wait for others to get there, the world of Italian scholarship was mired in tepid compromises and foolish ideas. In this point of view, in his mind, if the Jesuits really wanted to do something, they needed to get on board with what he had shown and be done with it. To them, their seeming equivocation was beyond maddening. Having lined out these two perspectives, and to be clear, there are others as well, it should be noted that they are not mutually exclusive. Galileo could be both arrogant and concerned that the church is making a huge mistake. He can see himself as both an eagle flying high above the rest and still a servant of the capital T truth. He can be both hurt and hopeful that change might come. And in 1623, a change did come, one that would open new opportunities and set new traps for a man who possessed the fatal flaw of ego. So what was it that both brought Galileo back to Rome in 1624 and convinced him that he could ignore Grassi's overtures? To put it succinctly, it was the election of a man with whom he had carried on a number of scientific discussions as Pope. Maffeo Cardinal Barberini of Florence had been elevated to the office of Pontifex Maximus by the College of Cardinals in 1623. As you will recall, Cardinal Barberini had been one of the two individuals who had presided over the debate regarding states of matter at the table of the Grand Duke of Florence back in 1612, and had come down solidly on Galileo's side in the affair. The two men had remained in touch, and Barberini was sympathetic to both Galileo's ideas and his plight, even saying at one point that had he been Pope, he would not have allowed the Inquisition to sort of do the things it had done in 1616. When he was elected as Pope Urban VIII, he invited Galileo to Rome to initiate what he called, quote-unquote, an intimate friendship, meaning a client-patron relationship that would benefit both parties. So what was the basis of this? Well, Pope Urban had a problem. He had, of course, inherited the 30 Years' War. And while things on the military front, at least at that point, were not tremendously problematic, He was a smart enough man to recognize that if he won the war, but not the hearts and minds of those he was fighting, it would be a pretty pyrrhic victory. He had received reports that, for many of the Protestant intelligentsia, the censures of 1616 were very much a sticking point for considering other Catholic ideas. In other words, if the Church wouldn't let scholars discuss the ideas of Copernicus, how was free and open discussion of any number of other issues to occur? If questions of natural philosophy were going to be decided by theological dictate, what was the role of the natural philosopher? It wasn't that the individuals disagreed with the conclusion the Church had reached, i.e. that Copernicus was wrong, but how it had gotten there and what the implications were for those who might want to discuss the issues or any number of other similarly contentious ideas such as atomism or the existence of a vacuum. What Urban needed was a way to show the intellectual community of Europe that the restrictions on intellectual discourse the reign of Paul V and Bellarmine had established weren't as rigid and set as stone as someone might think. Now, what Galileo needed was a way to discuss Copernicus and heliocentrism without getting himself condemned as a heretic. As we know from the historical record, not only has he already been accused once in the 1615 event, he will be accused more than once after the 1623 publication of the Assayer of being a heretic. Galileo is pretty well aware that his enemies see him as vulnerable, and that one strategy that's worked to muzzle him in the past is to make accusations of heresy about him to the Inquisition. While Galileo was certainly not alone in suffering from this tactic as a way of silencing opponents, his close brush with the machinations of what took place inside the congregation of the Inquisition made him well aware of the need to have protectors in high places if he's going to stick his neck out. His friend Barberini, now Pope Urban VIII, is about as good a protector as he'll ever get. So, when he travels to Rome, over the course of about 6 meetings, and by the way, we don't know really very much about the details of these 6 meetings, but as a result of these, a sort of agreement seems to have been reached. Galileo was asked to publish a work on the causes of the tides, or at least something close to it, and the Pope would keep the Inquisition off his back, more or less. An important caveat in this is that in no part of the work could Galileo treat the ideas of Copernicus as real. Any and all references to heliocentrism had to be introduced hypothetically or as just one side of a discourse or argument. In this, Urban stressed that Galileo must not assert that heliocentrism was the only way to explain the various observations. In other words, Galileo could argue that Copernicanism was plausible and consistent with the observations, but not that it was true. The idea, of course, was to show that the Church was willing to allow such discourse among its faithful, even as it upheld its previous rulings. What is somewhat remarkable is that Galileo, having had 8 years to think about it, seems to be much more willing to accept this restriction than he had been back in 1616, when more or less the same solution had been offered by Bellarmine. Now, before we move forward, there are a couple of other things we should mention as a part of this. Again, we don't know what the two men would have talked about in their meetings, but the sources I'm using are pretty much in agreement that the Pope would have wanted to know Galileo's ideas, and thus would have asked for an explanation of them. In other words, the two would have talked about the matters at hand. This likely would have led them into a discussion about those issues, during which the pontiff would probably have made his ideas known. He would have offered up his thoughts and his understandings of the issues at hand. In this, you need to remember that all members of the clergy, at least at the level of bishop and higher, had to have gone through formal university training and thus would have taken not only the standard liberal arts curriculum that led to the baccalaureate degree, but then they would have earned first a Master of Arts before moving on to the theological work. As such, a man like Urban would have been fairly familiar with at least the fundamentals of Ptolemaic astronomy and the arguments for, and maybe now at this point, against its validity. Moreover, it is likely that while a cardinal in Florence, Barberini would have kept abreast of both Galileo's and Castelli's various researches, especially after the publication of the Sunspot book in 1613. The other thing was that before any agreement would have been reached between these two men, either Urban or his agents, most likely the latter, would have made sure that Galileo was free from any real taint of heresy. There would have been questions asked about the events of 1616. Now, Urban couldn't have his guys just go looking in the files of the Inquisition. Doing so would have created all kinds of rumors and difficulties for the project these two guys were trying to set up. Instead, Galileo would have been asked what had happened and what the outcome had been from those hearings back then, with the expectation that Galileo, as a client in the relationship, would give all of the necessary and relevant details. Of course, the question is, did Galileo actually know all of the necessary and relevant details? Did he know about that fourth document, that injunction that had been placed in his file in 1616 that forbade him to hold, defend, and again, this is the important word here, teach the ideas of Copernicus? Whatever the case, Galileo did not tell either Urban or his agents about that stronger injunction, and since Bellarmine was now 3 years in the grave, no one could ask him about the proceedings. So, in 1624, Galileo set to work on finally writing the piece of scientific discourse that he had promised the Grand Duke of Florence he would write way back in 1610 before everything went sideways. He made fairly quick progress on an early draft, and soon he decided to write a letter to a religious figure in Rome that had written a work to contradict Copernicanism. And in Galileo's letter to this figure, Galileo rebutted the points he made one by one. However, due to rising tensions associated with the Thirty Years' War, the letter, while circulated, was really actually never shown around in Rome, as everybody agreed that rocking the boat at that particular time was actually probably a pretty bad idea. So, soon, Galileo became sidetracked, and it was this time with a variety of family issues that led to the project getting shelved for quite some time. Once more, to his friends anyway, it looked like the whole thing might never see the light of day. However, in 1629, Galileo fell very ill. Finally recognizing his own mortality and realizing that his greatest work might never see the light of day, he got back to work finishing up. The illness, coupled with his failing eyesight and fear that he was beginning to lose his mental faculties, created in him an urgency that would prove to be his undoing. To get the book published, he needed to convince four people that it did not contradict the censure of 1616. The first was the Pope's personal theologian, the Dominican Niccolo Riccardi, known in some circles as Father Monster due to his enormous girth. Galileo felt very confident that his approval would be easy to obtain due to the fact that Riccardi had been the one who had approved the publication of the Assayer 7 years earlier. The second person was the Pope's nephew, Francesco Cardinal Barberini. Francesco had concerns about whether or not Galileo thought of the Earth as a star, something that was theologically problematic. It was Castelli, Galileo's colleague, who worked with the cardinal nephew to assure that any such confusion would be rectified. The third person was Raffaello Visconti. Visconti was Riccardi's point man on working through the details of the text and making sure that any difficulties would be ironed out. In his instructions, however, Riccardi made it clear to Visconti that Galileo's work was to get favorable treatment for a variety of reasons, most notably because the Pope wanted the book published. Lastly, of course, there was the Pope himself, whose prestige was on the line to some degree in this. Now, before we get to the evaluation of the dialogue concerning two chief worldviews, let's take a moment to talk about the structure of the book. It follows Galileo's favorite method of writing, a conversation between a few people, or a dialogue. In this case, it was between a Copernican, named after Galileo's close friend Salviati, who had died in 1614, an Aristotelian who was named Simplicio, and a third person who was undecided but that would weigh the evidence and the arguments of the other two. This guy was named for another of Galileo's close friends who had died, Socredo. There is, of course, a fourth voice in the dialogue, the academician, who occasionally chimes in to offer additional clarification and evidence or to summarize the arguments, and this voice is most certainly the voice of Galileo himself. This fourth voice is certainly also a supporter of Copernicus, as evidenced by the tone and content of the comments he makes in the dialogue, something, by the way, that will be brought up against Galileo in his trial. The book has four parts, corresponding to 4 days of discussion and debate regarding various matters relevant to the matter at hand, and was supposed to be published by the Lyncean Academy under the sponsorship of its founder and leader, Prince Cesi, who had published almost all of Galileo's previous works. Unfortunately, Cesi died on August 1st, and from there, things really kind of spiral out of control. By August 24th of 1630, Castelli has sent a letter to Galileo urging him to have the book published in Florence and to have it published quickly. And that's wrong. Matters in the Thirty Years' War had become tricky again. The Habsburgs of Spain had captured a duchy in the northern frontier of Italy from the French, and Gustavus Adolphus of Sweden had invaded Germany. The Pope was uncomfortable with Spain's ascendancy in Italy, as it threatened to deprive him of what political power he had on the peninsula. However, supporting France would be taking the side of the Protestants in the war. The Pope, who had long served as an ambassador to France from the Papal States when he was a cardinal, was predisposed to side with the French, but couldn't overtly do so. The Grand Dukes of Florence, on the other hand, were in somewhat the same position, with the exception that they were more closely allied with the Habsburg of Austria, and so leaned towards the Spanish. What this did was put Galileo, the Florentine, and the Pope on the opposite sides of the not exactly, but really still an internal political conflict. So bad were things in Rome that supporters of both Spain and France took to the streets in a series of brawls that made it clear to everyone in power that this was very possibly a no-win situation. And so, in 1630, the Pope is really on the horns of a dilemma. The whole situation continued to get worse throughout 1630. As Galileo was trying to get the dialogue approved, and eventually the whole thing became something akin to one of those Tom Clancy or Robert Ludlum political thrillers, with conspiracy and murder and double dealing and backstabbing and all of the rest centered around a person by the name of Ozario Marandi, a somewhat debauched abbot who was closely connected to Galileo and, it turns out, Raffaello Visconti, who, as you will recall, was tasked with approving the dialogue. The whole thing is way too convoluted to go into here, though those of you who enjoy those sorts of things should check it out. But the turmoil over the entire affair added to the haste in the rush of getting this book into print. And also, it managed to get the whole process transferred from Rome back to Florence. Over the course of 1631, there were various intrigues to get Father Monster to approve the book, and in due time, Galileo called in any number of political favors to exert political pressure on the reluctant theologian. While expedient, this turned out to be tremendously unfortunate for Galileo, because once things went south, there was no one near the Pope who would be willing to stick his neck out for Galileo, as everyone was too busy trying to protect their own. Before we discuss the consequences of the book's publication, let's take a step back, as that will help us put things in proper context. What Galileo has done here is forget the true nature of the relationship established in 1624 that allowed him to move towards the publication of the book. He was the client in a client-patron relationship, and as such, he was in the dependent, less powerful position. In his mind, he was the one with the right knowledge, the correct understanding that would pull the church out of the backwater corner it had painted itself into. In his mind, the church was correcting an error he had tried to prevent 15 years earlier. As such, he saw all of the obstacles and barriers that seemed to be cropping up as things to be pushed aside or overcome. Never does it seem to have entered his mind that the foot dragging that was taking place on so many levels might mean that he was getting himself into something bad. His fear of death and having what he thought to be his greatest work lost drove him away from the path of working with Visconti and Riccardi to identify those issues that might be problematic and then working through them so that they would not be seen as objectionable in the eyes of the Pope. What he doesn't understand at this point is that he's performing a service for his patron, Urban VIII, who is willing to reward him for his obedience. The deal was that Urban would let Galileo publish for the reason that it would show that the church welcomed open intellectual discourse of a hypothetical nature as long as Galileo didn't embarrass the church or contradict the censures of 1616. Galileo assumed, and not without reason it should be said, that the Barberinis, like so many other Jesuits, were at least favorable to Copernicanism, and so as long as he provided them a bit of cover, they'll let the whole lot of stuff slide. And maybe that would have been true if the Pope hadn't been under attack for siding with the Protestants, or at least the French, against the staunchly Catholic Habsburgs in the Thirty Years' War. Instead, the Pope, the one last figure Galileo had to convince, wasn't in a position to be generous, and when he found out the details of how the book came to be approved, didn't care much for the way Galileo had violated that client-patron relationship by bringing political pressure to bear from the Medici family. Had Galileo slowed down at any point? Had he stopped and said to himself, you know, maybe I ought to back off and engage with any of the people who are responsible for guiding this tremendously sensitive project through a very complex progress? Then there's a good chance that a lot of what's about to happen could have been avoided. Of course, there's also a chance, maybe a pretty good one, that the dialogue would never made it out of the manuscript stage. When the book's first complete copies rolled off the printing presses in February and early March of 1632, it caused an immediate uproar. Within days, the authorities of the Inquisition were trying to round up every single copy that had made its way to Rome. The Jesuits were angry for reasons that will become clear in a moment, and so was the Pope. While Galileo had made a passing reference to the argument that the Pope had made a condition for publication, i.e., that Copernicanism was to be presented only as a plausible idea that was consistent with the evidence, Urban was not in the least bit satisfied with how Galileo had done it. The reason for this was that it is in Simplicio who utters the phrase the Pope had insisted on, and in every other argument in the dialogue, Simplicio had been portrayed as just being wrong. Any astute reader would have seen this, and those who read between the lines would have likely assumed that Galileo was in fact mocking the Pope and the Church in this assignment of the words to that figure in the dialogue. At this point, the excrement hits the rapidly rotating air movement device pretty quickly, and a lot of people got into a lot of trouble. While no heads literally rolled, several did figuratively. Galileo was summoned to Rome to answer to the Inquisition. At first, both he and the Medici family protested on account of him having very poor health and various types of adverse travel conditions, not limited to just being the plague, which was just raging through Florence during this time. But Urban was absolutely insistent. Galileo would come. Galileo would answer for his words. The charge was to be heresy. In time, a delay of 1 month was negotiated, in which people on both sides hoped would allow for tempers to calm and an arrangement to be worked out where the book could maybe be withdrawn and corrected, thus saving everybody a whole lot of embarrassment. Then, the other shoe fell. The file from 1616 was reopened, and the Pope was shown that fourth document that, along with some other notes related to the testimony that Cecchini made about Galileo's teaching heretical things to students, created a huge set of problems. So why did this happen? It's hard to put it all together, but here's what most historians seem to agree on, at least the ones that I've read. In the part of the dialogue where Galileo talks about sunspots, he seems to have lifted language directly from the work of that Jesuit astronomer, Scheiner, that we mentioned in our episode there on sunspots a couple of weeks ago. Scheiner has tried to patch things up with Galileo in around 1625 and seems to have been pretty agreeable towards Galileo's arguments in favor of Copernicanism by this time. So, when he saw that Galileo had taken his work without any sort of attribution, he must have been pretty angry, pretty steamed. At this point, Scheiner's working in Rome and probably had access to some of the Jesuit records going back to 1616. And so he probably knew that there was a file on Galileo from that time. In an act of revenge, he made sure that the file and its contents got to the Pope's people and then sort of just let the rest take its course. Galileo arrived in Rome on the 20th of January in 1633 and reported to the rooms of the Inquisition on April 12th, and he would remain there until April 30th. As things progressed through the trial on heresy, Galileo became more and more aware of just how bad things were and just how isolated he actually was, that he had actually no friends anywhere in Rome who were willing to stick up for him. However, things were not exactly straightforward in the process of determining his guilt on this charge of heresy. Galileo stuck to his guns on a couple three claims. First, in his writings, he did not claim that Copernicanism was true, nor had he defended it. Galileo's claim was that he had only discussed it. Now, while this may have been true in terms of the words that were actually written, it's very clear from the tone of the dialogue that Galileo was being a bit disingenuous about the defending part of his claim. Everybody could see that. He had definitely gone further than just discussing it in terms of the tone of the document. The second defense was that he had never seen the injunction that was supposed to have been read to him. He pointed out that he had never been given a copy of the injunction and that the one in the file lacked Bellarmine's signature. In fact, he could not recall the injunction ever having been read. This put the Inquisition in quite a bind. Either the injunction was sort of a falsification, and thus Galileo hadn't really violated the Church's instruction, or the Church hadn't followed its own rules of justice, something that brings the entire process into question. In either case, moving forward without a confession of some sort from Galileo would create a rupture in the relationship between Rome and Florence, something not advisable given how things were going in the Thirty Years' War. Third, Galileo insisted that the book had been improved by the censors and had been given the proper bishop's imprimatur, though, as we've seen, this was arrived at by dubious means. He'd used a lot of connections to apply political pressure, most certainly from the Medici family. He explained, though, that if the book was not acceptable, that the error was the Church's, not his. With these three arguments, Galileo put the Inquisition in quite a bind, and there wasn't a clear way out of it. So, on April 27th, with things at an impasse, Vincenzo Macalano, the Inquisition's Commissary General for the hearings, came up with a strategy that might resolve the issue. He went to Galileo and he said that if the impasse wasn't resolved, he would be forced to allow Galileo to be interrogated with quote-unquote greater rigor, read torture, in order to establish the truth. Galileo, who, due to his age and increasing infirmity, was in no state to undergo such rigors, was willing, therefore, to listen to options. Galileo explained that all of this, plus any truly significant consequences, if he were convicted on the charges that now stood, could be avoided if Galileo abjured, admitted some small wrongdoing, did the appropriate penance, and suffered some minor punishment. If, on the other hand, Galileo continued to resist, Macalano said that there would be additional charges brought against him related to his support of atomism and its implied rejection of the core theological belief of transubstantiation, the idea that during the Eucharist the bread and wine of the sacrament become the body and blood of Christ. This charge had been based on a report that had been generated at about that time due to something found in an appendix of the Assayer, which of course had been published 10 years earlier. A report, by the way, that Scheiner likely had a lot of input in drafting. It was a classic carrot and stick approach. Give in and take a little bit of bad medicine, or possibly don't give in and end up like Giordano Bruno. Galileo, though, wasn't completely fooled by this. He likely pointed out that the assayer bore on its frontispiece the papal arms and was read aloud at mealtimes to the pontiff, and so the charges of, you know, some sort of heresy associated with that document would be hard to make stick, and if they did, would cause enormous, and I mean enormous, additional embarrassment to the church. Still, though, he was willing to listen to a deal. What he was offered was that all he had to do was admit that it was easily possible that someone reading the dialogue might form the wrong impression about the purpose of the work. Something, by the way, that's pretty obvious due to how it had been received by a lot of people. However, he would not have to admit that such had been his intention. In other words, he didn't have to plead guilty to defending Copernicanism, but instead just to appearing to do so. He had to be willing to admit to being careless in his wording. And while this may seem like some sort of kind of set of hair-splitting distinctions, it allows everybody to save face, which of course in politics is oftentimes the most important thing. What Galileo, though, didn't get in all of this was some assurance as to the nature of his punishment if he pleaded guilty to this much-reduced charge. What Montalano figured was that he had set it up so that Galileo could be released without undermining the authority of the Inquisition or embarrassing the church, and that the book would be removed from publication, both of which were goals of the head of the tribunal, Francesco Barberini, who of course at this point is now implicated in the entire fiasco and just wants to make it all go away. All of this, of course, has to be worked through the various bureaucratic channels so that it wasn't basically until about June 21st that Galileo would be required to appear again before the Inquisition. Now, when he shows up, they once again interrogate him, and they do it this time while showing him the instruments of torture and explaining in some detail what each of the instruments did in that same ritual that Johannes Kepler's mother had endured some 13 years earlier. Galileo again denied that he had ever been committed to Copernicanism, and he insisted that his book shouldn't be read as a defense of it. He was then once again threatened with torture and imprisoned for the night. Give him a chance to think it over. The following day, he dressed in the white robes of a penitent and confessed to the crime, or at least whatever you want to call that, confessed to the thing that he had agreed to confess to, and was declared guilty, and I love how this is put, of having given grounds for suspicion of having held Copernicanism. And then his sentence was read. He was forced to abjure the ideas of heliocentrism and Copernicus. He had to watch as a copy of his book was burned in front of him, and then he was sentenced to the prisons of the Holy Office at the pleasure of the Pope. It was a stunning and horrifying outcome. Galileo was to spend the rest of his life in a dank prison cell. So how had this come about? He had played ball. He had agreed to the lesser charge. This punishment seemed totally out of, you know, proportion to what he had actually confessed to being to have done. Well, what I've been able to learn is there are really two main factors. First, the other cardinals of the Inquisition, at least several of them, decided that Galileo had to be lying when he said he knew nothing of the injunction that had been placed in his file. The second factor was that the Pope had decreed on June 16th that Galileo had to abjure de vehementi, or with all vehemence, thus making Copernicanism heresy, something it had not been up to that point. Thus, while the letter of the agreement had been kept, the Pope made it clear that the spirit would not be and told the cardinals to throw the book at the old man. Why? Well, we don't know for sure, but I think it had a lot to do with that client-patron relationship thing. Urban had trusted Galileo to do the right thing, and then Galileo had been self-serving. In the relationship, if the client did something that would embarrass the patron, the client was supposed to take the fall and accept the blame. Galileo, in his trial, did not do that. He did the opposite of that. He, in essence, blamed the church and, by extension, the Pope. So the Pope made sure that Galileo would never, ever be able to do that again. And it's worth noting here that when the cardinals were asked to sign the verdict and the sentence, only 7 of them agreed to do that. The other 3 said they didn't want any part of this. And that's an important point to understand. Galileo here is actually never convicted of heresy, even though from this point onward, he will be treated as a heretic. The outcome of the Pope's anger and decision was that Copernicanism and all works associated with it were now banned in all Catholic lands. Inquisitors across Europe were instructed to summon professors of philosophy and mathematics in their towns and read to them the condemnation of Galileo so that there would be no question about this matter. In doing so, the pontiff suppressed much astronomical work that might otherwise have been done by the talented astronomers of the Jesuit order, many of which clearly agreed with Galileo's positions. It also ensured that all works would now be published by the Protestant presses, notably in the Netherlands and in England. For Galileo's part, he didn't have to stay in the Inquisition's prisons for very long. On June 30th, the Pope allowed him to be transferred to the residence of the Archbishop of Siena, where he was kept under house arrest for about 6 months before being allowed to return home in December of 1633. Here, he would remain under a sort of house arrest for the rest of his life. While he was not allowed to leave the residence except to attend church services on certain days, and even then he was not allowed to speak to anybody while at the service, he was allowed to receive visitors. And occasionally he was also allowed to leave for various important functions with the Grand Duke or other kinds of things. In essence, while he was a prisoner of the Inquisition, he was not really held by the Inquisition. Still, though, he could be returned to their prisons at any time without cause or warning. Additionally, he was not allowed to publish a single word, at least not in Catholic lands. Of course, with his network of colleagues, Galileo was able to circumvent this last restriction with a bit of subterfuge. His works on Copernicanism, including the Dialogue, would be published by the Elsevier family in Holland, and later, so would his Dialogue on Two New Sciences, which contained his work on motion and hydrology. So what are we to make of Galileo and his Dialogue? Without question, the Catholic Church was wrong. Something immediately glimpsed by the Archbishop of Siena, who is said to have told visitors during Galileo's time with him that history would prove Galileo correct. Something, by the way, that got a note written up on him for the Inquisition and placed in his file. But this is not to say that Galileo didn't have a hand in his own misfortunes. There are those who suggest that Galileo didn't have proof, quote-unquote proof, of his conclusions, and in a sense, that is true. Stellar parallax, that most convincing demonstration of the Earth's motion around the Sun, wouldn't be observed until 1838 by Frederick Bessel. The direct observation of the Earth's rotation would have to wait until Foucault's pendulum in 1851. Yet, I don't think anyone would say that the Earth's motion was doubted or held in question by any learned person as late as those times. Almost all historians, I think, will say that by the publication of the third editions of Newton's Principia, the Earth's motion was well established, as was Kepler's elliptical description of the heliocentric solar system. Yet, to be honest here, little additional evidence had actually accumulated by those dates that hadn't really been available to Galileo. So, what's the change here? Well, I think the change that led to the acceptance had more to do with methodology than evidence. And if such a standard is retroactively applied to the work of Galileo, and I know that's something kind of tricky, I think it can be said that he was more than justified in his claims supporting Copernicanism. One of the modern criteria for something to be scientific is that it solves new problems with new models or theories. In the case of both Kepler and Galileo, it's clear that their work does actually do this, and it does it surprisingly well, building off the work of Copernicus before them. not only do Galileo's telescopic observations banish the model of Ptolemy, the specific work with the timing of the eclipses of the moons of Jupiter and the orientation of sunspot rotations are much better fit to the Copernican model than they are to the Tychonic model. While Galileo doesn't have a definitive demonstration of the motion of the Earth, he does have a preponderance of the evidence, and so it's my belief anyway that his conclusions are more than warranted. Where Galileo errs is in his inability to work with others who are not in full agreement with his ideas and interpretations. This is not due to there being a lack of individuals within his sphere of contact who are competent, but rather due to his ego and arrogance. To be clear here, I do not wish to engage in victim blaming in the case of Galileo's conviction on something that looks a little bit like heresy, but I would be fallacious to suggest that Galileo didn't have a hand in his own downfall. Had he, at any one of the possible junctures, taken the olive branch offered by the Jesuits, 1616 or maybe 1633 might not have happened. Had he not rushed the publication of the dialogue through the use of political pressure, he would have avoided stepping on one of the, if not many of, the landmines that he ended up stepping on. Had he been willing to give credit to others and engaged with them in scholarly discourse, there wouldn't have been so many lined up to see him put in his place. Without question, I think, in the story of Galileo, there are many lessons to be learned by both the scientist and those in the broader cultural context that wish to engage in looking at science or the results of science. Those lessons, however, will have to wait to another time. As we close, let me wish everyone a Happy New Year on this first day of 2017. May everyone to whom these words come have a safe, joyful, and prosperous next trip around the sun. Thanks for listening to the show, and know that I'm really looking forward to some of what we have coming up in the months ahead. There's Descartes, Newton, Halley, and the Herschels still to be discussed. We'll look at the successes and failures of discovering new worlds, and somewhere down the line, we'll get into the work of the Harvard calculators, Harlow Shapley, and Hubble and Humason. In this spirit, I would be remiss if I didn't note the passing of a woman about which we'll have something to say down the road, Vera Rubin. Dr. Rubin passed away on Christmas of 2016 at the age of 88. Her work on galactic observations provided the best evidence for the existence of what we call dark matter, and should have, in my and a lot of other people's opinions, earned her a Nobel Prize. My personal connection to Dr. Rubin was that after leaving her work on dark matter observations for a time, she made a series of telescopic observations of a type of galaxy known as an S0 galaxy. This type of galactic system is made mostly of stars with very little hydrogen gas or dust. It has the disk shape, but no spiral arms, and so looks something like a sort of cross between elliptical and spiral galaxy types, for those of you who know something about that. In her research, she found that some S0 galaxies possess a significant percentage of the stars that rotate in the opposite direction around their galactic centers as compared to what the majority of the stars in the galaxy do. My PhD work at the University of Florida was to do some of the earliest computer modeling of these types of systems to see if we could figure out what the effect of those counter-rotating stars were on the stability of those galactic disks. Without Dr. Rubin's observations, I would never have started on this project and might never have finished a dissertation. She was a profoundly curious and inquisitive woman who was deeply optimistic and who overcame enormous systemic gender barriers to leave a lasting mark on her profession. More than that, though, she was an unflagging advocate for those who were underrepresented in the sciences: women, Hispanics, African Americans, and a number of others. And she helped make sure that they were considered on an equal basis for any number of opportunities she herself was denied. May she rest in peace. Next week, we'll look at the world of astronomy following the condemnation of Galileo for heresy and see what work was done to advance humanity's understanding of its place in the cosmos during that time. Until then, full sails on your journey.